Each year, Microsoft Research hosts hundreds of influential speakers from around the world, including leading scientists, renowned experts in technology, book authors, and leading academics, and makes videos of these lectures freely available.
Thanks so much for coming. My name is Amy Draves, and I'm delighted to welcome William Urey to the Microsoft Research Visiting Speaker Series. Bill is here to discuss his book, Getting to Yes with Yourself, which is a prequel to his now classic manual for negotiation. He is the co-founder of Harvard's Program on Negotiation and a world expert on the subject. He, with former President Jimmy Carter, co-founded the International Negotiation Network, which is an NGO seeking to end civil wars around the world. More recently, he founded the Abraham Path Initiative, which seeks to build bridges between cultures and faiths. He has authored several bestsellers in addition to Getting to Yes, including The Power of the Positive No. Please join me in giving him a very warm welcome.
Well, it's a great pleasure to be here with you this afternoon here at Microsoft. And I want to talk with you about one of the most important competences that we, that you as individuals and as organizations and as societies, what I believe is one of the most important competences we need in today's times. And that's the competence of negotiation, of getting to yes. Getting to yes, I define very broadly as the act of back and forth communication. You're trying to reach agreement with the other side. You have some interests, perhaps, which you hold in common, like an ongoing relationship, and you have other interests which are in tension. And I've had the privilege over the last 35 years of witnessing a revolution that's taking place around the world that accompanies the knowledge revolution, the information revolution. And it's a revolution in the way in which individuals such as ourselves, organizations such as Microsoft, the way in which we make decisions. Because traditionally, a generation or more ago, in most places of the world, the main way in which decisions got made were the people on the top of the pyramids of power gave the orders, and the people on the bottom basically followed the orders. And now, thanks to the knowledge revolution, those pyramids of power are slowly flattening into organizations that resemble more networks. And as that happens, the form of decision making shifts from vertical decision making to horizontal decision making, shared decision making, which is just another name for negotiation. So that nowadays, in order to get our jobs done, or to get decisions made at home or in the world at large with world problems, if we want to get what we need to negotiate. And so, let me illustrate that and actually invite you to think about your own negotiating experience. If you think about who you negotiate with in the course of your day, just the variety of situations that you might encounter, you wouldn't mind just calling it out. Who do you find yourself negotiating with in the course of your day? Your spouse, okay. Who else, some of the tough negotiations. Who else do you negotiate with in the course of your day?
Your boss.
Your boss.
Coworkers.
Your coworkers.
Kids.
Your kids.
Policeman.
Okay.
There's a lot of fast cars in the parking lot.
Right. I noticed. Who else do you negotiate with? Anybody else?
Customers.
Customers, for sure. For sure. So if you think about it for a moment and you had to make a ballpark estimate of how much of your time you spend engaged, broadly speaking, in the process of getting to yes, negotiating with your spouse, your kids, your coworkers, your boss, your staff, your customers, policemen, what would you say it was if you had to put a guess on it? What percentage of your time you spend, broadly speaking, in that act of back and forth communication trying to reach agreement?
80%?
Okay. How many would say it's at least a quarter of my time, just out of curiosity? At least a quarter. How many would say it's over half? Okay. Yeah. So, and maybe how many would say it's, 75 or, 80? So it's, whatever it is, this is a huge, we don't think of it as negotiation in the formal sense of the term, but in the informal sense, it's a huge fraction of our time that we spend engaged in this process. from the moment we get up in the morning to the moment we go to bed at night. And let me just ask you one further question, which is, if you think about the 10 most think about the 10 most important decisions you had to make over the last year, the ones that had the greatest effect on the bottom line and your job and getting things working, 10 most important decisions, how many of them could you just make, just purely by yourself, you're the boss, and how many of them do you actually have to reach with other people, in other words, through some process of shared decision making? 10 most important decisions you had to make in the last year, how many of them, in effect, did you need to negotiate? What'd you say? All 10?
All of them.
So, and one other question here, just about your experience. If you think about the last, say, 10 years of your work experience, you know, as you've kind of gotten more authority, you've risen up in the organization, you may have more power and so on, would you say that the amount of negotiating that you're doing has stayed pretty much the same over the last 10 years? Has it gone down maybe as you've gone up in the organization, or has it gone up? I would say it's gone up, sorry, curiosity. That's what I'm talking about. That's the negotiation revolution, and that's intensifying. And we're the first generation to really have to negotiate as much as we are. And, you know, dealing often with people across cultures in all kinds of ways, and using technology, using the internet and so on. There's so much room for innovation here, and it's necessary, because to me there's really no problem in the world really that we can't solve if only we can learn to collaborate, if only we can learn to get to yes, if only we can learn to resolve our differences. So it's a huge and innovative challenge that I think with the use of technology, but with the kind of creativity that we've put into new technologies, if we can put it into the soft technology of how human beings, organizations, societies can learn to get to yes, even in challenging situations. So let me ask you, I think you'll probably get more out of today's talk if you have in mind at least one challenging negotiation that you're currently involved in. Could be at work, could be at home, just something that's giving you a little bit of problem. If everyone have something in mind, some situation, a difficult conversation, a tension, a conflict, a negotiation. So let me, everyone got a situation in mind? I'm sure you might even have more than one. So let me ask you, if there are two types of negotiations, or the ones inside the organization or inside the family if it's a personal situation, like, for example, with your spouse and kids, or inside the workplace with your boss, or your coworkers, your colleagues. And then there are the negotiations outside the organization, for example, with customers and suppliers. How many of you, out of curiosity, when I asked you to think of a challenging negotiation, picked an external negotiation outside? Okay. How many of you picked an internal one? Okay, interesting. Of those two, which do you think, do you personally, if you had to make a broad generalization, which do you find more challenging, the external situations or the internal ones? How many would say the external negotiations are what give me most problem? Okay, how many would say internal situations give me the most problem? Now you look at the hands go up here. Now it's interesting, I find that to be true, but it's, you know, obviously both can be very challenging, and in fact, external negotiations often have an internal component that make them particularly challenging, but it is kind of curious that the negotiations that we often find to be most challenging are people with whom we're on the same team, we're in the same family, you know, we have the same, you know, mission objectives and so on. Those are often the most challenging. So, which then leads me to, you know, my own experience over the last 35 years, because Roger Fisher and I collaborated on Getting to Yes many, many years ago. And since then, you know, I've had occasion to work in all kinds of situations, from business disputes, boardroom battles, labor strikes, family feuds, civil wars around the world, you name it. And people say, oh yeah, you know, I'd like to get to yes, but the problem is the other person. You know, the problem is the difficult people, that difficult organization. How do you deal with that? How do you deal with someone who's absolutely rigid in stone walls? How do you deal with someone who's not willing to negotiate? How do you deal with someone who's got more power than you? And I've written extensively and worked extensively on that. But over the years, it gradually dawned on me, since I was really, my passion is really helping people and organizations and societies get to yes. And I'm always asking myself, what stops us from getting to yes? Where are the obstacles? And it slowly dawned on me that actually perhaps the biggest obstacle to us getting to yes, the yeses that we want, to getting what we really want out of a negotiation or out of life generally, is not the difficult person on the other side of the table. It's however difficult they can sometimes be. The biggest obstacle to us really is right here on this side of the table. It's us. It's the person we look at in the mirror every morning, because it may not be so curious, because after all, if we experience internal negotiations as more difficult, what could be more internal than the negotiation within ourselves? So our biggest opponent might be that person, but that's also our biggest opportunity if we can learn to turn that opponent into our own ally. And that's really what I want to talk with you about, is that first and most important negotiation, which starts within us, which I found is perhaps the most challenging negotiation for many of us, but it's also potentially the most rewarding. And it's often the key first step if we want to get to yes with others, is first to get to yes with ourselves. It's almost as if I realize we've been negotiating, and I've been helping people, think about how we influence the other side. And it's without really focusing on how do we influence ourselves. And it's almost as if we've been negotiating with one arm tied behind our back, just by focusing externally when I think it benefits, particularly with the challenging situations we have in our daily lives and in the world, we need all the help we can get. So we need to both harness the inner and the outer. And so what I've learned is that getting to yes starts off as an inside job. And that's what I'd like to focus with you a little bit about, is how do you get to yes with yourself? What does that mean? How do you turn yourself from an opponent into an ally? So I'd like to talk to you about a few principles. Perhaps the biggest obstacle I find is what makes us our own opponent is we human beings, we tend to be reaction machines. And particularly under stress, particularly in conflict situations, we tend to react. As Ambrose Bierce once put it, when angry, you will make the best speech you will ever regret. And that happens. That happens. So it's almost as if there's kind of three natural human reactions, particularly in times of conflict. One is we tend to accommodate. Out of fear, we don't want to strain the relationship, we don't want to lose the deal, whatever it is, we tend to accommodate, we give in. Another reaction is, perhaps out of anger and out of irritation, is we go on the attack. So that's the second A. And the third one, particularly I would say common in internal conflicts, internal tensions like the ones you raised your hand, or the more challenging ones, we avoid. We don't talk about it. It's just too difficult, it's too sensitive, so we don't talk about it. How many of you, just out of curiosity, if you had to kind of diagnose your own style, your own kind of negotiating style, how many would say that sometimes you have a tendency to accommodate? You notice a tendency to accommodate. Okay. How many would say you sometimes have a tendency to attack? Okay. How many would say you have a tendency to avoid? Okay. So, and oftentimes it's a combination of all three. In fact, we may accommodate for a while, and then we kind of say, okay, that's it. And we go on the attack, and then we realize, wait a minute, I just damaged the relationship. So then we go back to avoidance. And we go around a little bit like a rat in the maze, And the question is, how do we break out of that? And how do we learn to engage with our differences in a constructive way that meets our interests, is not accommodation, is respectful to the other, is not attack, but and actually addresses the issues. And I think where that work begins is right here with us, is really in understanding ourselves, learning to work with ourselves, both so that that gives us more satisfaction, but also so that it makes us much more effective at getting along and dealing with others, particularly in challenging situations. So for me, the foundation of being able to work with ourselves is the ability, I like to use a metaphor of going to the balcony. It's almost as if you're negotiating on a stage. Part of your mind goes to a mental or emotional balcony overlooking that stage. It's a place of perspective, it's a place of calm, it's a place of clarity, it's a place of self-control, it's a place where you can keep your eyes on the prize. And these days, it's harder and harder to go to the balcony and to even stay on the balcony because, you know, there's so much going on for us. We're living in much more stressful times thanks to technology, thanks to cell phones and emails and texts and tweets all flooding in all the time. You know, so often you're sitting here there at your desk, you get a message, an email from someone, a coworker, and you realize, hey, I got left out of an important decision. And you feel irritated, you feel frustrated. How come they didn't consult me? So naturally the tendency is you just compose a reply and you get that satisfaction of hitting the reply button, but you don't just hit the reply button, you hit the reply all button and it goes out to the entire organization and you see conflicts start to escalate. Well, there's a little button on the screen which is rarely used, which is the one that says, which I think of as the balcony button. It's the one that says save as draft. And that's the one where you kind of compose it, you save it as a draft, and everyone has our favorite techniques. You all have your favorite techniques for going to the balcony. Some of you might, you know, go out and get a cup of coffee, go for a workout, go for a walk, talk with a friend, sleep on it. Whatever you do, you're going to come back, look at that email from a place of perspective, and you're going to ask yourself the important question, is this really going to advance the situation? Is this really going to advance my interests? And you'll probably answer no, and you hit the delete button, and then you'll pick up the phone, call the person, get together with them if possible, and try to resolve it in person in some way. But so that's going to the balcony. And I've found that in my own personal and professional experience, it's really my ability to kind of cultivate my ability to go to the balcony is increasingly important. If I may just share one quick story from my own professional experience. Some years ago, I was invited, asked by President Carter to go to the country of Venezuela at a time when it was highly polarized. There were a million people on the streets of Caracas, the capital, demanding the resignation of the president, Hugo Chavez, and a million people on the streets supporting him, and there was some violence, and there was some fear that it might even tip into a civil war. And anyway, I spent the better part of a couple years going back and forth. And one meeting in particular, I remember that I had with President Chavez, I had a number of them, but was at his palace. The meeting was for 9 o'clock at night. He liked to work at night. And I was waiting there with my colleague Francisco, and 10 o'clock went by, 11 o'clock, midnight. Finally, we're ushered in to see the president. He had his entire cabinet arrayed behind him. And he gave me a chair. He said, so, Bill, have a chair. Tell me, give me your impressions. How are things going here in Venezuela, according to you? And I said, well, Mr. President, I've been talking to some of your ministers. I've been talking to the political opposition, and it seems to me that there's some progress. As soon as he heard the word progress, he got triggered. He said, what do you mean, progress? Are you a fool? Are you naive? You're not seeing the dirty tricks those traitors are up to. And he proceeded to lean very close into my face and yell at me for approximately 30 minutes. Well, you know, if I put myself in my shoes for a moment, you know, I was thinking, wow, okay, 2 years of work down the drain, you know, I'm feeling kind of embarrassed in front of the whole cabinet and everything like that as he's yelling at me. But somehow, I remembered a friend of mine had once told me, he said, Bill, if you're in a tough situation, remember to pinch the palm of your hand. And I said, Hernan, why would I pinch the palm of my hand? He said, well, because that will give you a momentary pain and it'll keep you alert. For some reason, I remembered to pinch the palm of my hand just to remember to go to the balcony there and ask myself the question, is it really going to advance? You know, I felt like defending myself, you know, and say, you're wrong, I'm not naive, but would it really advance the situation, the cause of peace, for me to get into an argument with the president of Venezuela? And so I determined the answer to that was no, so I was on the balcony, and I just listened to him. And I just paid attention, listened to him from a balcony perspective, and sure enough, here was a man who could go on for 8 hours with a speech, no problem at all. I'm sure if I'd rebutted him, we could have, you know, everything would have gone south very fast. But just by listening to him, I watched his body language, his shoulders kind of slowly sank, and after, and he said to me in a weary tone of voice, he said, so Bill, what should I do? Well, that is the sound of a human mind opening, because oftentimes we're dealing with people who are in an irate state of mind. And when people are in that state of mind, they're not going to listen to reason. It's like beating your head against a wall. But if you can just listen to them, use a psychological method for a psychological problem, then, you know, then suddenly there was a little bit of an opening. And so he invited me to, he said, what should I do? So I said, well, Mr. President, if I were in your shoes, I would invite the entire country of Venezuela to go to the balcony. In other words, it was December. I said, you know, last December, the Christmas festivities were canceled because of the conflict. Why not just give everyone, declare a truce and give everyone a chance to enjoy the holidays with their families? And when we come back, you know, then everyone will be perhaps in a better mood to listen. He said, that's a great idea. I'm going to propose that in my next speech. His mood had completely shifted. In fact, he said, over Christmas, I'm going to travel around the country, and I'd like you to come visit the country with me. You ought to see it. But then he thought for a moment. He said, you know, you're a neutral, you're a mediator. Maybe it wouldn't be so good for you to be seen in my company all the time. And then he thought, but that's no problem. I'll give you a disguise. So what I learned from that was, you know, just, you know, that one of the greatest powers we have is the power not to react. It's the power to go to the balcony here. And it's not so easy, of course, because there's a tendency for us to, as many people tell me, you know, to fall off the balcony. You know, it's very easy in these reactive times to do that. So the question is, how do we stay on the balcony? Well, you know, maybe when people ask me, of all the skills that you need in negotiation, is there one that may be the most important? You know, usually I say it's this one. I say, negotiation is an exercise in influence. You're trying to change the other side's mind. If you're trying to change their mind, how can you possibly change your mind if you don't know where their mind is? Therefore, the ability to put yourself in the shoes of the other, to understand their needs, how they see the situation, their perceptions, is going to be critical if you're going to try and change their mind. It's the ability to listen to them. But what I found is, in teaching this over many years, is it's not so easy for us to put ourselves in the other side's shoes, particularly in times of conflict. It's not easy at all for us to listen. And what's in the way, what's the obstacle, is right here. It's us. It's in our own, all the thoughts and feelings that are already occupying our mind space, that we don't have any space to take in the other side's thoughts or feelings or how they see the situation. And we're so focused on our problems, we don't have any kind of attention to focus on the other side's problems. I got enough problems, I can't worry about their problems. And yet, only if, you know, if you're dealing with your boss, for example, only if you can help your boss solve their problems are they likely to be able to help you solve yours. And so, to me, the key, paradoxically, the psychological antecedent, the essential prerequisite before we can put ourselves in the other side's shoes, is to put ourselves in our own shoes. And while that may seem kind of strange, I mean, after all, we're not already in our own shoes, what I find is that, in fact, how many of us can honestly say that we truly listen to ourselves in an empathetic way, a little bit like a good or trusted friend would? Because usually what I find is, if we look inside of ourselves, there's a lot of negative self-talk often going on. Psychologists estimate that we have anywhere between 12 and 60,000 thoughts in the course of a day. Maybe as high as 80% of them are negative. You know, they're kind of like, that's wrong, that's not gonna work, you're gonna be a failure, whatever it is. It's almost like, there's that inner critic always going on, that inner brain chatter inside of us. that we have internalized from childhood, when we got all the criticism from our parents or from our teachers, from others, and so on. It's all there inside of us. And there's a saying that if we talked to our friends the way we talk to ourselves, we wouldn't have any. So what's the alternative? The alternative is to learn to put ourselves in our own shoes, to observe, learn to observe from the balcony, to cultivate our inner scientist, as it were. You know, I'm trained, my PhD originally is in anthropology, and in anthropology, the principal method of investigation is what's called participant observation, as you go into a foreign culture, and you don't just observe it, but you participate. You participate in the rituals and the daily life, and that's how you come to understand it. I think if we adopted that same method with ourselves, we participate in our own lives, but we also learn to observe ourselves, to invoke our inner scientist, and to listen to ourselves like a good friend might, then we might be able to uncover what our real needs are. Because this is another thing I find in negotiation, another way in which we get in our own way is we often don't know what we really want. And sometimes we're not even aware that we don't know what we really want because, you know, we're focused on the position. You know, I want that raise. You know, you're focused on, but what's behind the raise? Why do you want that? To ask those kinds of questions. You know, to give you a business example for a moment, about a year and a half ago, I got an email from a friend of mine down in Brazil who's a leading business executive down there. And she said, can you help my father? You know, he's one of Brazil's big leading business leaders, entrepreneurs. He built up a company of 150,000 employees. It's Latin America's largest retailer. And he's been involved in this titanic battle with his business partner for the last 3 years. There are arbitration suits, lawsuits, dozens of lawyers, probably a dozen law firms. It's all over the papers. The Financial Times was calling it the biggest cross-continental boardroom showdown in recent history, and can you help? I said, I don't know if I can help, but you know, at least I'll sit down and talk to the guy. And so I went to his home and listened to him, and this dispute everyone thought was just it was never going to be resolved. And he was slated to be chairman of the board for another 8 years, and every board meeting was just battles. So I asked him, you know, Abelio, tell me, I listened to him, I said, well, what do you want here? What do you really want? Because I could tell, first of all, he said, you know, should I fight? Just continue to fight because he felt very badly treated by his business partner? You know, or should I find a way out? He wasn't sure. And I said, well, what do you want here? And he said, okay. And he, you know, we're often clear about, okay, what we want. We can give people a laundry list of what we want. He said, okay, so I want my stock back at a certain price. You know, $1 billion or whatever it was. I want the elimination of the non-compete clause, a 3-year non-compete clause. I want some real estate. He gave me a list of things. But as I listened to it, I thought, you know, there's got to be something behind this. I said to Abelio, what do you really want? And this is the kind of probing that I think we could all benefit from doing, is just to probe, what do we really want? And after a while of conversation, he finally said, you know what I really want? Freedom. That's what I want. I want my freedom. And I said, well, what would the freedom be for? He said, well, the freedom, tell me more. He says, well, it's freedom to pursue the business deals I want to do in life, and freedom to spend time with my family, which is the most important thing to me. He was 76 at the time. And so I said, okay, Abelio, now that I understand that, you know, I was hearing the human being, not just the champion business leader. And once I understood that, then, you know, it wasn't necessarily easy to deal with the other side, but this had been going on for 2.5 years, broken negotiations. When I sat down with the other side in Paris about a month later, on a Monday, they said, so why are you here? I said, I'll tell you why I'm here, because life is too short. That's why I'm here. Life is too short for these titanic win-lose battles where everyone loses, and it wasn't just the parties losing, it was their families were stressed out. 150,000 employees of the company had divided loyalties, even straining relations between, commercial relations between Brazil and France. And he said, so how would you settle it? I said, well, if we could just agree on two principles here, which are freedom for both individuals to get on with their lives, and dignity, I think maybe we could have a crack. So he said, well, come by the office tomorrow. We went by the office tomorrow, and we just kind of outlined what would it mean to apply those principles of freedom and dignity to the issues at stake here. That was a Tuesday. By Friday, we had both men sitting in an office, signing an agreement, shaking hands, press conference, wishing each other well, making a joint speech to the executives and to the employees of the company, and the whole thing was over. And it wasn't just a split the difference compromise that would have been kind of grudging for each side. Abelio said, look, I got everything I wanted here, and most importantly, I got my life back. And the other guy was also very happy. So that, to me, the ability, where was the key? The key was, it's not just about getting to yes with the other. Abelio first needed to get to yes with himself before he could get to yes with the other. So it might be useful in your situation to ask yourself that same question of what's the equivalent of freedom for you? What do you most want or need in that situation? What's truly important here? What's the real prize? And then there was a question I asked Abelio in that situation, which was, you know, if you want freedom, ask yourself this question. Who can give you the freedom, what you most want in life? Who can give you that freedom? Is it only the other side, your business partner? Are you really just a hostage of this situation? Or at least to some extent, can you give yourself your own freedom? And that's this concept in negotiation, which turns out to be key here, which is developing what we call your BATNA. BATNA is an acronym in negotiation. It's always a good idea to have an idea of what your best alternative to a negotiated agreement is. It's your best course of action if you cannot reach agreement. Because in negotiation, we tend to focus on just the agreement. We don't think about, okay, if for some reason I'm unable to reach agreement with this person, is there an alternative way of meeting my interests? Because if we can figure that out, then it can give us confidence. It can change the power balance a little bit in that negotiation, and we're likely to negotiate more effectively. In this case, for example, when I asked that question to Abelio, he said, well, okay, what did he go on and do? He went on and said, okay. I said, independently of whether you reach agreement with this business partner or not, what can you do to give yourself the freedom? He went ahead and became chairman of another company. He went on a long vacation with his family. He pursued other business deals. And psychologically, paradoxically, by being less dependent on settling this, it was easier then to resolve the situation. And I think all of us can do the same thing, which is to think, for example, of what I call your inner BATNA, which is your own commitment to take care of yourself. In other words, what can you do to take care of your own needs independent of that situation? Asking yourself, you know, who is responsible for meeting my needs? What can I do to meet my needs independently of the other side? How can I take care of myself? I think you can change the psychology of it. You can develop more confidence. Because the best negotiations are when you care about the situation, but you don't care that much about it. Because if you care that much about it, you're going to come with a lot of fear or perhaps even a lot of anger or a combination of both, which won't serve you that well. So that brings us to the next challenge, or maybe the key challenge in negotiation, which is how do you change the game? And what I'd like to do is just invite you to participate in a quick 15-second little negotiation challenge for a moment, just to kind of illustrate this aspect of negotiation. If you wouldn't mind turning to the person next to you and getting into a kind of an arm wrestling position, just an arm wrestling, for those of you. Okay. You're in an arm, you know, oftentimes, negotiation's a little bit like an arm wrestle, you know? Okay. So, as in real life, you want to, you know, as in business, you want to maximize your profit here. You want to maximize your number of points. Let's imagine that every time you get the other person's arm down, you get 1,000 points, okay? Get ready, get set, go. Now, I'm watching a learning experience going on here. There's a fair number of us that start off, you know, 0-0, you know, Maybe, although I didn't see it, maybe one was stronger and maybe you got 1,000 points. But very quickly, quite a few of you said, wait a minute, trying to maximize my number of points. Okay, I'll relax my arm, that's 1,000 points for you. You relax your arm, 1,000 points for me. And like a windshield wiper, you're going back and forth, and pretty soon you're accumulating tens of thousands of points. To me, what that illustrates is that perhaps, because we often approach negotiations or conflicts like it's an arm wrestle. The underlying assumption, the underlying question is, who's going to win this, And maybe the greatest power we have as negotiators is the power to change that mindset, to change that dynamic from an arm wrestle into a search for mutual gain, where we can both, through cooperation, both accumulate a lot of points. And the question, so to me, that's the greatest power. But I'm always asking myself, so what makes that hard for us to do, often in situations? What gets in the way? And what gets in the way, I find first, is not just the difficult person. Of course, they can be difficult. But our own inner mindset around, we have certain assumptions about reality. And the person who really brought this to my attention was Albert Einstein here, who once asked, in the wake of World War II and the advent of nuclear weapons, he asked this question, is the universe a friendly place? This is the first and most basic question all people must answer for themselves. Now, why would Einstein be concerned about this? Because his reasoning was this. He said, if we, who knows whether the universe is a friendly place or not, but he said, this is a choice, this is a basic decision. If we choose to see the universe as a friendly place, then, or let me say it this way, if we choose to see the universe as an unfriendly place, then what's likely to happen is we're going to arm ourselves, collectively at least, we're going to arm ourselves to the teeth, and we're going to react at the first provocation. And given the weapons of mass destruction newly at our disposal, we're likely to destroy ourselves and everyone else. So if, however, we can answer that question as, is yes, the universe is a friendly place, we're more likely to treat implacable enemies as potential partners, or others as potential partners. We're more likely to cooperate. And we're more likely to get to yes, even in very difficult situations. And what he defined it is, it's a choice. And this goes to one of the great powers we have as negotiators, which is the power to reframe. It's one of our greatest powers, to reframe our own picture, our own mindset, our own assumptions, either as scarcity, that it's basically a zero-sum game. Resources are highly scarce. It's a dog-eat-dog world, or possibly we can redefine that zero-sum game as a positive-sum game where there's sufficient, there's enough for everyone. And so it's just, again, it's our own mindset. So we can ask ourselves these questions, which is, first of all, where does your satisfaction come from? Does it just come from outside, or to some extent does it come from inside? Can you see that there might be enough to go around? Can you see life? Can you see the universe is basically friendly? Can you see life on your side? And if I may just kind of illustrate that very briefly with a story, a personal story from my own family, which is my own daughter. I've watched this over the last, she's now 16. Her name is Gabi. And she, when she was born, from the day she was born, we discovered there were a lot of congenital anomalies, structural anomalies for her, and required like 15 very major surgeries over the years. But she reframes life. She doesn't see life as something like she's a victim of life, or that life is against us, against her, and something. She basically finds a way to kind of make every day count. And like, for example, she had her dream. She wanted to be in the Guinness Book of World Records. So when she was 7 or 8, she tried the longest hopscotch course, in the driveway with a piece of chalk. And then when about a year later, she tried the most socks on one foot. And last year, she told us, for my 16th birthday, for my birthday party, I'm going to break the Guinness Book of Records. And we said, well, what record are you going to go for this time? She said, I'm going to go for the longest abdominal plank. Do you know the plank exercise? Where you kind of you lie down, you put your elbows down, and you try to hold your body straight. I don't know how long you can do it for, but I can do it for about a minute or two. But she wrote her way to the Guinness Book of World Records, and the record was 40 minutes for women. And so she started training, and then, you know, a week before her birthday, she got a message actually from the current world record holder saying, in fact, that she had beaten her own record. She was just submitting it again to the Guinness Book of World Records. It was now 1 hour and 5 minutes. Anyway, her birthday came, and her birthday party, and all the guests were there, and she was, you know, we had to bring in, you know, video cameras, a couple of video cameras, and independent witnesses, and so on, just in case she broke the record, so we could submit the evidence to the Guinness Book of World Records. And by golly, if Gabby didn't go for 1 hour and 20 minutes.
Wow.
So the next week she was on Good Morning America, and if you look at the Guinness Book of World Records 2015, you'll find her in there. And so to me, that's just kind of an example of someone who's able to, just very close to home, who's able to get to yes with herself, and in doing so, she was also able to help others too, because she used it to raise money for the hospital where she'd had all the surgeries. So she raised, I think, using the internet, setting up a little website, she raised, I think, $58,000 for Children's Hospital in Colorado. So to me, it's basically, if we can go to the balcony, put ourselves in our own shoes, develop our own inner BATNA, reframe our picture, then like Gabby, we can stay, you know, athletes call, you know, or artists talk about the zone, you know, it's this kind of state of peak performance and peak satisfaction. We can stay in the zone when it comes to negotiating and dealing with others, which allows us to break one of the great traps of conflict, which is when the other side rejects us, we tend to reject them. When they disrespect us, we tend to disrespect them. If we can learn to respect the other side, even if at first they disrespect us, we have a chance to change that. You know, a great example of that, you know, was Martin Luther King, for example, or Gandhi, you know, who are able to kind of respect their adversary and somehow change that dynamic, which then allows us to get into a cooperative cycle of giving and receiving rather than just taking, which just shuts it down. I mean, the key with, you know, the negotiation with my friend Abelio, the Brazilian, was they were just focused on what they could take from the other. But once we focused on what they could give freedom and dignity to the other, then we created a positive cycle where they're able to get to a yes. So what that brings us to is we start with an inner yes, brings us to an outer yes, and then it brings about 3 possible wins for us, which is a win inside of us of greater satisfaction, you know, that we get to yes with ourselves, but it also brings, you know, a mutual gain solution with the other, so-called win-win, but it also engenders a more generous perspective, which allows us to bring about a win, not just for ourselves and the other, but for the family, for the workplace, for the community, ultimately for the world. So let me just leave you with one last story before we turn to questions, which is, I'm just headed off to the Middle East in a couple of weeks, and I'm reminded of one of my favorite negotiating stories from the Middle East. Was an inheritance dispute between 3 sons who received from their father an inheritance of 17 camels. And first son, being the older one, received half, the middle son received a third, the youngest son received a ninth. Well, 3 sons fall to negotiating about their inheritance, and each one wants more because 17 doesn't divide by 2, and it doesn't divide by 3, and it doesn't divide by 9, and they get into a quarrel. Brotherly relations get strained. So finally, in desperation, they go and they consult a wise woman about their problem, and she thinks about it for a while, and she says, I don't know if I can help you, but at least if you want, you can have my camel. So they say, fine, okay. So then they have 18 camels. Well, 18 does divide by 2, so the first son takes half of 18 is 9, and 18 does divide by 3, and a third of 18 is 6. Second son takes his 6, and the youngest son takes his 9th, and 9th of 18 is 2. If you add 9 and 6, you get 15 plus 2, 17. They have 1 camel left over. They give it back to the wise woman. Now, if you think about that problem for a long time, I think you'll find that a lot of our negotiations are a little bit like those 17 camels. No way to divide it up, too difficult. Somehow what we need to do is take a step back to the balcony, like that wise woman, reframe the situation, change our assumptions, and look for an 18th camel. And my proposition to us is that 18th camel might in fact be us. That's the 18th camel. So I want to wish you all the best in getting to yes with yourself in order then that we can get to yes with others. Thank you very much. So, all ears for any questions that you might have. Anybody? Yes, please.
I'm interested if in doing this work, you have found that a greater sense of compassion has arisen within yourself. And how important do you think that is to the process of getting to agreement?
Right. Everyone can hear that question, or should I repeat it? The question was, have I found that in doing this work that a greater sense of compassion has arisen within myself? And then the follow-up was?
And how important do you think compassion
is? How important compassion is. That's a really good question. I don't think I've gotten that question before. And it's, if I had to say so, I would say yes. Because essentially, I work in a whole variety of situations where in order to influence, I have to put myself in someone else's shoes. Therefore, I have to show empathy, compassion. And it naturally, when you put yourself, if we go through that exercise of putting ourselves in someone else's shoes, the more remarkable things happen. I'll give you just an example, if I may, just from a couple years ago. I've been working in a number of conflicts around the world, but one conflict that is a terrible and tragic civil war that's going on right now in Syria. And so a couple colleagues and I decided that we would, as a first step, we would go and try and listen to the parties and try and find out what are their interests, what do they want, how do they see the situation. So we carried on a number of interviews, and one set of interviews was with Syrian rebel commanders. That we went right to the Syrian border, right on the Turkish-Syrian border, and they basically stepped across the border, and we would do these in-depth interviews. And one of them, I remember, the very last one we had in that session, was a young man, probably around 30, I would say, who was the exact, stereotype in our Western imagination of a terrorist, he looked like, the long beard. He was a fundamentalist Muslim and whatever. So, I could just watch my preconceptions. But then I started asking him questions. So I said, he was a commander of, say, 2,000 rebel fighters in the north of Syria. And I said, how did you get involved in this? How did it all start? And he said, well, I was in university. And I said, so what were you studying in university? He said, well, I was studying poetry. And I said, you're studying poetry? Yes, he said, I'm a poet. I'm from a long line of poets. And then he declaimed some beautiful Arabic poetry for me a little bit. And I said, so then how did you get? Well, he said, well, I was arrested and I was tortured and a number of times, my uncle too, and whatever. That's how he got motivated. And I said, I was asking him different questions, and I said, let's imagine, that you survived this war. What do you want to do with your life? And he said, well, I've got my love. She's in Egypt. I fell in love with a girl in Egypt, and I'm hoping that if I survive, we'll be able to get together. And then I asked him a question later on. I said, let's imagine your side wins this war. What are you most concerned about for your country, for Syria? He said, well, the thing I'm most concerned about is the extremists. And I said, you're concerned about the extremists? Yeah, he said, I happen to believe in, Sharia law, Muslim law. He said, but I don't believe that we should just force it down people's throats if that's not what people want. But I'm afraid about the people who do. And then the last thing I think I might have asked him was, any message you want to send back to people in the West? And he said, you watch this war maybe on your TV screens and you see us just as numbers, he said, but just remember that every number that you see is a woman, child, or man who has a soul. Well, that was a 3-hour interview, but you can imagine at the end of the interview, it's like you see someone as someone who's, kind of in the enemy category, but by putting yourself in their shoes, you begin to understand. And it was an example of where compassion is key and empathy. And there's a big difference also is that if you want to change anyone or change any phenomenon, you have to begin by understanding it. And it doesn't necessarily mean that you always agree with anyone or you agree with their behavior, but the ability to understand and empathize turns out to be key to me. And as a result of those conversations, one of the greatest gifts or the greatest concessions you can make in negotiation in terms of the cheapest concession you can make in a negotiation is to simply give someone respect, is to treat someone with dignity, and you'll find that it costs you nothing, but it actually means everything to them. There is another question. Yes, ma'am, in the back. Amy.
This is an online question. What about the situations where you just can't make any headway, but the stakes are super high? And the example that Jeremy gave was negotiations that occurred between homeowners and creditors during the housing crisis.
The question, should I repeat the question? So everyone can hear?
Sure.
So how do you negotiate in situations where the stakes are super high and you can't seem to make any headway? And as an example, the negotiations between homeowners and creditors during the crisis. So first of all, I would say, you know, all of us probably face those kind of situations from time to time where the stakes are very high for us personally. It may not be, you know, Syria, but it's our own family or workplace, and where things don't seem to work well, which is why this is a challenge. This is, to me, one of the greatest evolutionary challenges for humanity right now, for anyone, for individuals and so on. And the first step in any situation like that, first is, obviously, the foundation is, you know, go to the balcony, and from the balcony, ask yourself, what are your interests? What do you really need in that situation? What's your BATNA? What are you going to do if, for some reason, you're not able to reach agreement? You know, that it's sort of interests, and it gives you a sense of confidence and power. And then you know, just to really analyze the situation and put yourself in their shoes, understand, listen where they are. The other thing to think about is that it's not usually just a two-party negotiation. It's often, like in this situation, there are many parties. And sometimes you can involve third parties. I mean, it could be courts, lawyers, political figures, neighbors, whatever it is, to build a kind of a coalition. You may not be strong enough to deal with that situation, but you could build an alliance or a coalition of people who can then deal with a situation like that. And all I can say is that in my 35 years of, I remember when I started working in this field, I focused a little bit more on, in the beginning at least, on international negotiations and conflicts. But back in those days, in the 70s, we were working on, like, say, the Cold War, which everyone thought was absolutely intractable. There was no way the Cold War was going to end. It was going to go on for as long as we can. You know, then there was the war in South Africa. That was going to be a bloodbath for as long as anyone could imagine. Northern Ireland, you know, Catholics and Protestants, that was a religious war and hundreds of years, and children were being brought up and just to kill each other, and that was never going to end. And there were others too, but those I've watched as patient, persistent negotiation combined with strategic, you know, even nonviolent action and various moves, leadership like Nelson Mandela or whatever. I watched as the Cold War shifted, South Africa shifted, Northern Ireland shifted. And one thing I would say is, one thing I learned from that is that sometimes we think, you know, it's about resolving a conflict, like peace just means no conflict. But actually, in fact, what I find is, it's not so much that, it's not so much about conflict resolution, it's about conflict transformation, because the conflict continues. You know, the conflict between the United States and Russia has continued, but we're not thinking of, you know, thermonuclear war. There's a conflict in South Africa has continued, the conflict in Northern Ireland has continued, but it's the form of conflict has transformed from destructive, using war, violence, or, you know, in families, you know, all the kinds of ways in which it can be destructive, even verbally or physically, or in the workplace, to constructive forms of conflict, which include cooperation, but also constructive confrontation, engagement, and using that. And that's the aim. And if you take that, you know, it's not to say that you're going to have immediate success in any situation with negotiation techniques, but you'll bring an analysis to it, you'll bring a power analysis, and you can often, what I've found is often situations that seem totally intractable actually can yield over time patiently into solutions that don't necessarily end the conflict altogether, but change the form of it. Yes, ma'am.
So you have a teenage daughter. I have a friend who has a teenage only daughter. She doesn't want to finish high school, get her degree. And they're in conflict all the time.
Right.
All the time. How do you deal with something that's so close? I mean, you talk here about dealing with yourself, but how do you deal with like a child who's so, is almost part of you, right?
Right.
How do you step back and
yeah.
you negotiate that it's okay not to go to college? Two more years and she's not going to go to college. You
know? Yeah, yeah. Listen, I know I have a lot of friends facing those challenges because it's the same age, but the, they can be incredibly difficult situations. And what I've found, this is why I probably, you know, this is one reason why I wrote this book about getting the yes with yourself, is I found that, you know, it's very hard to influence your teenage daughter. Really hard, you know? Hormones, I don't know what's going on, lots of going on. The one place where you have the most leverage is influencing yourself. If you can influence yourself so that you're not quite as reactive, so that from a balcony perspective, you can watch this as a play and you can see where you, say as the parent, trigger your child and where your child triggers you. You know, it takes two to tango, but it takes only one to begin to change that situation. If you learn not to react, a little bit like I learned, you know, with President Chavez, you know, yelling at me, you know, because people are going to behave in all kinds of irrational, difficult ways. But if we have a choice about how we choose to, we can choose to react, or we can choose to respond proactively, or we can choose not to react. And so then there's a chance to change the game. And to think about, to think about your BATNA, you know, about, okay, maybe, you know, for the next 2 years, you know, you may not have the very best relationship with your daughter, but can you have a live and let live arrangement, you know? But I find that the work starts really within ourselves, because as parents, it's going to be very hard for us to let go of our children. We also, it's just intensely uncomfortable not to have a good relationship with our child.
And she feels like she's ruining her life.
Right.
You know, like it's done, it's over.
Right, and it's not. You can go to the balcony and get that perspective. So I think first thing I would recommend to your friend is take care of herself. Yeah. Yes, ma'am.
I'm wondering if you think that the work on negotiation has anything to bring to the prevention of interpersonal violence, like domestic violence and sexual assault.
Sure. Does negotiation have anything to bring to the prevention of personal violence, like domestic violence and sexual assault? I'm just repeating it for those who might not have heard it. I believe so, very importantly, because if people can learn to negotiate for themselves, part of negotiation is learning to assert what's important to you. Part of negotiation, which is why I wrote the book just before getting to Yes with Yourself and Others, which is, you know, you can find more information here, but is the power of a positive no. The ability to say no, and for women in particular, I think, you know, the ability to say no and set boundaries and clear boundaries and do that, to me, is absolutely key. Negotiation, basically, the two key words in negotiation, yes and no. And sometimes, you know, we're kind of socialized to, it's almost like we have two arms, a yes arm and a no arm, and we're socialized to use the yes arm, you know, from the time we're little. You know, we even call the age when children learn the word no, we call that the terrible twos. We stigmatize the word no, right? But that's actually, developmental psychologists tell us, a really important age when the child is learning to assert their own selves, you know, define their own identities and so on, individuate. So I'd say that the ability to learn negotiation, because often often that kind of violence is taking place within a very intimate context with relationships and so on. So the ability to renegotiate those relationships, and at the same time to know your BATNA, which might be to get help from external authorities and so on, if you need, from the police or from help. So to me, it is a kind of negotiation, but oftentimes people who are involved in those situations, they want to continue and some find a way to continue the relationship in some way. Sometimes they have to resort to their BATNA. But to me, negotiation and learning methods of negotiation, of self-assertion, while understanding the other side turn out to be key. Yeah.
Time for one more?
Yes, one more. Yes, sir.
So in your example from Einstein, it kind of speaks to the idea of framing the problem and the environment. But one of the, in that vein, currency in negotiation is kind of one of the go-to solutions, providing currency in interpersonal relationships or in dealing with others, those kinds of things. But have you thought about the idea of currency as part of a negotiation with oneself?
A currency, just what you mean by currency?
Not money.
Yeah, I know. Or,
you know, I mean, you know, there's always give and take.
Right.
How do you earn those chips?
Right. Exactly. Yeah. No. I think that's true. To me, in it's almost as if when we're negotiating with people, there's social capital. We basically make deposits in, you know, we have of goodwill. And so in negotiation, for example, every time you show respect to the other side, you're making a deposit that you can then draw upon. And so to me, one of the mottos in negotiation is to be soft in dealing with the people, hard in dealing with the problem. Why? Because so often in negotiation, we fall into the trap of, we need to solve that problem. Okay, get the problem solved, so we ignore the person. We ignore the human and the psychological elements, and then we're surprised when, you know, that person gets angry and sabotages or spoils it. Or we make the opposite mistake of we want to be soft on the person, so we end up being soft on the problem, just making concessions and accommodating. And to me, what you find successful negotiators do, it's almost like they draw a line, they distinguish between the people and the problem, so that simultaneously they can be soft in dealing with the people, make deposits of currency in that, so that when it comes to dealing with the problem, that you can deal with the problem on its own merits.
And you think that applies the same way when in dealing with yourself, like, you know,
absolutely, yeah, to being soft and dealing, in other words, being respectful. I mean, you know, it's interesting to me, where does respect towards others come from? It's got to come from self-respect first and foremost. And so if we can listen to ourselves, we can better listen to others. If we can make some deposits of currency in our own, you know, in other words, if we can come from a place of self-sufficiency because we've taken care of our own needs, paradoxically, that's far from selfish. That actually makes us more able to be generous with others. Oftentimes what I find is we think, okay, we want to be kind to others, but we do it with a lot of self-sacrifice here, and then it's kind of artificial, it's strained. But if we learn to, and this is what getting to yes with yourself is about, is if we can learn to take care of ourselves and our own needs to some extent, we're going to be much more available to others. That's the paradox. By getting to yes with ourselves, we're much better off at getting to yes with others and creating a more altruistic, generous environment for everyone. And if you look at, I mean, just as an example, you know, people like, I don't know, I mentioned, you know, like King, for example, you know. He did a lot of work inside himself. I mean, if you watch that movie, Selma, he was negotiating with LBJ, right? He was carrying on. But at the same time, you know, he was dealing with his own inner demons, his own inner doubts. He was trying to get to yes with himself, try and draw on his own, you know, inner resources so that he could bring it to that negotiation. And if you look, you know, or take, you know, I mentioned South Africa, take someone like Nelson Mandela as an example. In prison, when he was there in prison, He said what he learned was the art of observing himself, of observing his thoughts and feelings and becoming master of himself, because he was kind of reactive, he was a kind of a boxer. He learned to master himself. He learned not to blame just the other side, but to take responsibility. He then, by being able to take care of himself, he learned the language of his adversaries, which was Afrikaans. He studied their history. He put himself in their shoes. He had compassion for their history. When he emerged from prison, he was then able to engage with them, speak with them in their own language, stand up for the rights of not just of his own people. He said, I'm fighting for the freedom of whites and blacks, for all South Africans, and thus was able to respect them, even if at first they didn't respect him, get them involved in cooperation, forgive, and basically, as a leader, by drawing on his own inner resources, able to help transform an entire society and inspire the world in the process. By getting to yes with himself in prison, he was able to get to yes with others. Thank you very much.